ready to go. All right, so what we do, it's conversational style. So okay. I will start the show and then we'll get into our discussion, okay?
Sure.
All right, so for sound, wait, let me just turn off one thing. I'm back. Welcome to God and Matter. My name is Arlene J.M. Grant. I'm your host, and today's guest is Elijah L.X. Harvey. Elijah is multi-talented. He's an entertainer. He's a storyteller. Elijah, that's who I say you are. But who are you?
That's pretty accurate. You know, first and foremost, a man of God, you know? Yeah, that's pretty accurate. Producer, entertainer, storyteller. Yeah, you know it. Spot on.
Okay. And Elijah, where are you based?
I'm based in the DMV area. Okay. I grew up in Capitol Heights in D.C.
Okay. But didn't you live in Europe for a while, too?
Yeah. I was born in Landstuhl, Germany. Both of my parents were in the military. And so that's where I was born. And we were in a couple of places before then, but I don't remember. But most of the time, at least since I was like 4 or 5, I've been in the Washington area.
Okay. Does that upbringing in Europe in any way influence who you are as an artist, as a person?
Yeah, I always wanted to go back. And, you know, being there is different because, you know, as a kid, they say, hey, where are you born? This and that. And they say, like, you know, Southeast or somewhere, you know, something like that. So it's always interesting. It's always been interesting to say, hey, I was born in Germany. And a lot of other military brats say they were born in Germany, you know, other places like Japan. So it's like a nice little conversational piece.
So your moniker is LX, and your website for listeners that want to find you is lxismusic.com. Cool. How did you become LX? How did Elijah become LX?
Well, you know, I never really felt like I fitted in with the general public. I still feel that way today. So LX means living in exile. I just took the E off, you know. But basically living among the world, but not being of it. But living. But okay with being who you are and your ideals and your morals and, you know, what you stand for. So living in exile. And that's a name I came up with when I was like maybe 12 years old.
It's interesting, you know, artists are said to have a more sensitive existence in order to create. There's a connection with the creator. Do you think that that contributes to your feeling like you're in exile?
To be transparent, sometimes, yeah. I've recently, in recent years, found ways and how to connect with people who may not exactly share the same mind state, but the same experiences. And that's when I started, you know, storytelling and kind of being more transparent in my experiences so you can understand who I am as a person, even though I'm kind of reclusive, introverted.
Okay. So that's really interesting. Your story is also very unique. I mean, we met like years ago on MySpace. And then one of your events, and then we just seem to keep in touch. And so, and you're a good cook. For those who don't know, you can barbecue. Okay. But, how did you become a musician? What was your inspiration? You came from a military family.
Oh, that was random because, you know, neither my mother or my father are really into music like that. I mean, my dad sings in church or whatnot. But when I was in about 5 or so, maybe a little bit younger than 5, my parents had an organ in their basement. I don't know where they got it from because, again, neither of them did music. I don't even know why they had it there. But back in the day, sometimes the pianos and the organs have these paper key-like things to tell you the notes that you're hitting that sits on top of the keys. And with the notes, they had a hymnal on the side. So I figured out that the notes matches the hymnal. The first song I remember was Silent Night. I still can't read, but I knew it was G-A-G-D or something like that. So I just hit the keys according to the book, and I realized, you know, this makes sense. Then I just got away from reading the music and just figuring it out by ear and picking instruments as I aged and, you know, just trying to get better in the craft. I love music. You know, it's just that and combined with like the Disney afternoons and the TV shows and their theme songs, I still to this day think they are the most intricate, complex pieces of musical work I've ever heard. And that really inspired me. That and video game music. So that and just experimenting is just kind of how I've grown to love music.
Well, your music is very different. It is really beautiful, and I love your style of singing.
I appreciate that.
You have a very nice melodic voice, and your voice is different. You don't sing about the same thing that we hear all the time. It's not more money, more women, what you can do to a woman sexually.
That's not what I'm about.
Yeah, and I applaud that, because it's not the message programming that the system status quo likes to put before listeners. And I do believe, like, old hip hop had messages attached, and I do respect the fact that your music has messages attached. Now, are you on a label?
Well, currently I'm doing a venture with Empire right now on the code. MBN is my label. I've had that for a while. But yeah, I'm definitely running concurrently with Empire at this time. I've got some other things on the table, but I'm not at liberty to speak yet until the ink is dry. But yeah, I'm currently working with Empire.
Okay, so you have MBN is your private label, and
yes,
then you're looking, or you're working with Empire Records.
Yeah, I distribute through Empire, correct.
Now, your distribution chain, because there's some people who want to make music, and then they find you, they might be inspired to even create music. What was your process? Because I think you're self-taught.
Correct. Yeah, I just kept being bad at it until I got good at it. And that's with everything. I try to encourage people, excuse me. I try to encourage people, not just with music, but just with art or anything that they love or like, but they don't think they can do themselves. You know, a lot of the best fans are the best creators. And I like to compare it to dating. So say you meet somebody, if you meet somebody or find something that's interesting to you, like dancing or something like that, and you go out on a date. Now, that first date may not be, you know, like a match made in heaven, but you get to know something about it. And a lot of people tend to leave after that first date. Now, if you continue to mess with it, even because you're hopeful and you want to be good at it, or you want to get that person to like you, you have to constantly learn and evolve and fail and try and fail and continue trying until you get to know that person. In other words, until you're good at what you're doing. You know, a lot of people quit the first day, say, I'm not good at this. No, you're not going to be good at this. You're not a black belt the first day. So that's kind of how I tell people, like, keep going at it. If this is what you want to do, you got to spend time on the craft. You can't just, you know, find shortcuts. You've been doing this for years. You can't come in and start the thing. You know, you understand? You know, it's like dating. You're not going to know that person and be ready to marry them the first day you meet them. You got to just learn it and see if it's for you or if it's not. And keep trying.
That's good advice. Now, in this keep trying, okay, I know that you did a lot of your distribution working yourself initially.
And yes.
You ended up going to the Grammys, is that right?
Yeah, I've been twice. I'm a Grammy member. I'm a voter as well. I think in 2015, I ran to be a governor, but I didn't make it. But, you know, I've been trying to get people in there and trying to unite the area as far as the D.C. chapter for some time now. I think it's a great union, and I think, you know, we can all support each other. I encourage every musician to look into the Grammy Academy and see if it's for you. They have, every city has a chapter, so I would definitely encourage people to look into that, because it's definitely good to have as far as backing. And you get to have when you're there, you can actually have a chance to attend the Grammys. So they offer tickets and whatnot, so you can attend. And just to clear the air, only voters vote for the Grammys. You cannot be, it's not public domain. So if you're in there, you have a voice. So that's another reason why. Like, you can vote on people or not vote on people, but, you know, it's not a public thing, like people's choice. But definitely, it's definitely the move.
So did you have any fanning out moments? I know when I photographed the Golden Globes, I'm usually pretty good around celebrities, but I remember Dick came in front of my camera and I kind of couldn't take a straight picture of him. It was just like blurry. I was just like, do you have any moments?
Not yet, thank God. I think I would have a moment if I would have met Michael Jackson or if I met Quincy Jones, but yeah, I mean, I've kind of been around these people for some time, and they're just like you and me. I mean, you know, So no, I haven't found out yet because I look at them more as inspiration to where I want to be versus them, you know, some kind of, you know, superiority or whatever, you know, it's just inspiration. And I just see them as human beings and react to them as such.
It's true. They are human beings. It's interesting. Ang Lee is a really good storyteller. And I remember one of the years that I was photographing the Golden Globes, he won. And it was for Brokeback Mountain. And I remember going to him and he was eating, but I didn't want to interrupt his food, but he put down his food to actually focus and give me his attention. And I thought, truly successful people are humble and are not arrogant.
Yeah, and I definitely agree.
You know, very, very generous of spirit.
I agree. Those are some of the best people, and those are the most successful people I've met. You know, we all meet the jerks, but I think it's safe to say that a lot of them aren't doing what they used to do because of those reasons. But who am I to judge?
That's true. We're not here to judge. Now, you mentioned God. How does God shape who you are? I mean, you're a husband, you are a musician, you're a storyteller, entertainer, but how does God shape who you are in all aspects of your life?
You know, I pray every day. God is a big part of my life. I've been through a lot of things that I may not publicly share stories, but I've been through a lot of traumatizing things. And if it wasn't for God, you know, I wouldn't be where I'm at, because, you know, I've had moments of turmoil. Like I had a spiral when I got, you know, drunk every day because my father had prostate cancer. I couldn't deal with it. And that's just the tip of the iceberg of things I've dealt with. And if it wasn't for God and, you know, knowing and reading and like the lesson of Job, and when everything goes bad, you know, it's all about how you respond to things. And I truly just want to be a vessel and do God's work. You know what I'm saying? It's not about me. I used to think, you know, when you're in your early 20s, you just want to be famous and all that. And it's different now. I just want to do what I'm born to do. And I'm not here to be rich. I just want to, if I get my message out through God and somebody gets inspired, then, you know, I can leave this earth today and be a happy person. And that's just genuinely, you know, how I stand on things. I won't commit myself to things that are not of God. I won't be in things that are not of God. And, you know, a lot of people are abandoning Christianity, which I don't understand, but I don't judge at the same time. But I'm still here. And, God is everything. Like, I prayed that this okay, so this morning that I released would, you know, get me further in my reach. And I got a phone call prior to this podcast. Some really great news. Hopefully I'll be able to announce it soon once the ink is dry. But I'll tell you offline, but I'm just going to keep it quiet for now.
I respect that. And thank you. And good way to bring up Okeso. Okeso is hilarious. Okeso is like a stick figure, short story animation. How did you go from songwriting to writing stories that are hilarious and just
well, I think, you know, when you put music out, people don't really get to know you. I mean, they get to know your message and what you stand for, but they don't get to know your life and your story. So I figured it was a way to you know, tell my life and tell, you know, the crazy things that happened in my life, and you get to know me as a person. I actually got the idea from one of my partners, Gary. He had did a stick figure about a biblical story, ironically. I think it was about Joseph's jacket, and he did a biblical story, like it's about 1 minute long, and he used some stick figures, and it was hilarious. But I was like, hey, you know, I'm about to, can you mind if I take this idea and run with it? He's like, gave me the blessing. And now he was actually in my last Okeso. So we all run as a team, and it's just been a funny way and a quick way to just animate your life. So I'm blessed with inspiration, you know. Shout out to Gary.
Shout out to Gary, indeed. It's fascinating to me. When I first saw it, it's like, what is this? And I'm like, he's illustrating now? Or do you illustrate it?
Yeah, I do. I do. I draw it and everything.
Well, this episode that I saw today online, and I'm going to play another part of an episode for our listeners later in the podcast. You're now adding color and things to it. So your animation or your drawing is evolving as well.
Yeah, I'm trying, if I could actually animate, I'm trying to learn how to do that so I can really go in. But, you know, just baby steps. I'm on my, I think, 13th or 14th episode. So hopefully by episode 30, it'll be a whole different, you know, idea, because I really want to animate. So I'm just trying to learn that on the side right now. We got this coronavirus going on. I have time to figure things out.
It is giving people time to figure things out.
Yes.
Have you walked away with any lessons from it? How are you managing with that?
With coronavirus? Oddly enough, I've been okay. A lot of people, especially our extroverted friends, I don't understand, but I can empathize with. They're going through it, especially like a lot of people don't have the blessing of like, you know, being quarantined with their significant other or with their family. They might be in the house alone. They've been at home alone for like weeks. I mean, obviously, solitary confinement is a way of torture. So it's kind of being jailed in your own house. So I definitely empathize and, you know, help people find a way to deal with it. But me personally, I've been fine.
I have to tell you that I am quarantined alone. I don't feel like I'm in jail at all.
Well, you're an introvert.
I'm sorry?
You're an introvert.
I'm both. I'm an introvert and an extrovert. But
oh, you're ambivert.
Yes, ambivert. I find that I'm more creative now, and I like quiet anyway. I mean, I used to do silent fasts anyway. So, awesome. And I'm not like out in the street so much, you know, but
the same, yeah.
And you know how sometimes, and your wife who's listening probably can relate to this, she might laugh and fall to the ground, and you should put this in okay, so about how women have to go to the bathroom in pairs.
Yes.
I like that. If I need to go to the bathroom and I'm out with a friend, they don't need to accompany me. Do you know what I mean?
Like for what?
Sorry?
You know? It's like, for what? Somebody will come out there and rob you, you know?
I don't get it. I don't know. I don't have that need to connect like that. I love friends. I love people. I'm not like, oh, I hate people kind of person.
Yeah.
I just see this as such an opportunity. So,
I totally agree. It's an opportunity for growth and find out who you are, you know? I think God is allowing things to happen so we can grow in ourselves, because we're getting lost, you know? We're misguided with a lot of things, and it's just like, find out what you love to do in life. Find out your passions. This is people, most of us are 30, 40 years old and haven't found out anything about ourselves. Like, okay, this is your time to work from home. Okay, when that time is done, you don't have to drive. You don't have to be in traffic. Use that extra time to find out who you are. This is only one life. It's such a finite thing. And do you really want to leave this earth not knowing what you were good at and how you could bless this world? Really? You know?
That is a very good point. Say that again, Elijah, because people really need to hear that.
Do you really want to leave this world not knowing what your purpose was, what your gift is, who you are, and how you can contribute to the world and being a better society? Nothing happens or doesn't happen that isn't supposed to. Again, it's about how we respond. And I think a very healthy response to this coronavirus and being quarantined is to take this time to figure out who you are, figure out what you love to do. And I stated the patterns earlier, how you need to date what date different things or try things that may not be your comfort zone, because comfort will kill you. And just, you know, take this time and maybe come out this coronavirus, you know, a better person. This is a time to evolve, to be in our chrysalis, in our cocoon, and be that butterfly, because we've been caterpillars at 30 or 40 and we haven't evolved to who we are.
I'm clapping for you. I agree with that wholeheartedly. I know that people are impacted on so many ways, and there's so much destruction and there's so much anxiety, and people have lost their lives, they have lost their livelihoods. But yeah, it is also an opportunity. And I think that God, as we collectively call, you know, this source creator, is giving us a time out. I think that there's been so much distraction that's taken place that people have lost their ways.
Yes.
We're not about being ratchet, savage, and all these other kinds of things. That's not why we're here. Or to be nasty. Yeah. You know, you're supposed to enjoy life, but you're also supposed to make the planet better. And I feel like we have not been taking a step forward. Technology has advanced, but not necessarily us collectively. And this is an opportunity for us collectively to advance.
I agree. life is a gift. What are you going to give back? You know?
True. True.
Now you're just going to live on this earth and take and die.
That's true. You mentioned something earlier and I didn't want to dismiss it. You talked about coming through drinking daily after your father had a prostate cancer diagnosis. I don't know if you know, my dad went through prostate cancer as well. And it's a
I remember you telling me about that. Yes. And yeah.
How did you get through it? How did you stop drinking?
If I can be honest with you, well, today he's in remission. He's back at work. He's fully, you know, but that made me take her back. But then after that, when I got with my wife and whatnot, you know, I don't know. I got tired of being hungover every day and tired of gaining the weight and not remembering things. And just, you know, I had people around me who shouldn't have been around me. But when you're drunk all the time, you just want somebody to drink with. But, you know, demons get along. And sometimes it takes a sober eye. Now, I will say I do enjoy drinking every now and then. But it's not the way it was, killing half a gallon a day or half a fifth a day. It's not in that space anymore. I can't do that. I just can't. And then I can't do it physically. I'm almost 40. You know, I can't do none of that anyway. So I think just finding stuff to do, working on yourself, you know, not having an idle mind and not, you know, because things happen, everything's supposed to happen, so, or not happen, but it's like, it's a clarity. You start seeing everything for what it is and not hiding and not running away. I don't, you know, is that kind of, yeah, so I think that's kind of where it is. So, like my last release, Drunk and Depression, I wanted to really empathize with people who are dealing with those things because I understand, but at the same time, you know, the little girl got killed in the video. What you're doing to yourself affects the world around you and even innocent people. So, you know, either you want to build or destroy, and I don't think, you know, killing a fifth every day is really building anything. So that's honestly my story.
That's very mature of you, and I applaud you in your growth process. And
thank you.
You're talking about drunken depression. That video, and for those who want to check it out, LX made a video called Drunken Depression, and it's a PSA. And it is a startling, jarring video. And I had to take a look at it and think, you know, not everything is supposed to make us comfortable. The truth isn't always comfortable. But it's empowering to know and to be aware. So for those who are interested, take a look. And then also with what Elijah talked about in terms of putting down alcohol and knowing that that's not going to solve the situation and it's not good for you. And if you're loving yourself, putting something in you that's not building you up and tearing you down is self-destruction. So again, it's a good idea to look to see that you're not only potentially hurting yourself, but hurting others. Thankfully,
definitely.
That's not an autobiographical video though, correct?
Correct. No, it's not. It's just like, you know, and I want to say that, you know, it's okay to enjoy a drink. Like I may have a drink tomorrow after work or something like that, but you know, just in moderation, know your limits and know where you need to be and know if you have an issue or a problem. But it's, you know, like, it's not a sin to drink, but if you're just doing that to, you know, how I say, be Benadryl to allergies, which means that it just covers the symptoms and doesn't address the problem, then that's not good.
True. I'm glad your dad is in remission. That's really good. Now, with regard to married life, some people are struggling right now in that they're around their spouse 24/7.
Yeah, I mean, that's when you get to know who they are for real. But luckily, I've known my wife since 2002. And we were friends first, platonic friends for a very, 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 very long time. So I knew who she was. She was my video game partner. We hang out all the time. I mean, we got to the level where we used to talk to each other about our boyfriend and girlfriend problems, and we'd be our advisors to each other. You know, it's funny how God works. But so I'm quarantining with my best friend, so we ain't got no issues, you know. Oh, did you take the trash out? That's probably the biggest problem we have.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. A lot of people are struggling with that trash issue. A few others. I don't know if you saw it, but there was a woman who was having a conference call on Zoom, and her husband was in his underwear.
Oh, wow.
In front of her coworkers.
Oh, wow. No, I didn't see that. You're going to have me looking it up now.
Yeah, there are some issues that are taking place, but I think people, what tips, what advice would you give them? You're married. What would you say to people that are married?
I've only been married for 1 year. Okay, so I've only been married for 1 year. So I will just say, a year and a half, but I'll tell you what I've learned from my marriage thus far. I can't really give advice. Okay, so it's always good to communicate. When I say communicate, it's not like a broad term. Like, if you're upset about something, you should, you know, let your partner know in a calm way. Oh, that's, first of all, tone is everything. If you come out angry or whatever, it's going to be noise, and noise cannot be heard. So, you know, get yourself together, explain to, you know, your partner what's going on, and, you know, have a civil conversation. And don't talk at them, talk to them like a partner. And let them know what you want. Don't add extra stuff that doesn't need to be said, like insults and catty things, or, you know, petty things to, you know, solve the problem. Because you got to, if you're not interested in the growth of both of you and, you know, making it work, it's not going to work. A lot of people get in their own ways as far as in their own lives, and then they unite with somebody else who's in their own way. And it's just, you know how two positive magnets or two negative magnets repel. Somebody got to come and somebody got to pull in, and you got to connect.
That's good advice.
Yeah, I think that, and just, you know, date your partner, you know, joke with them, be friends, you know, anything going on, just talk to them, be transparent, don't see it and don't build on stuff, just speak on things and be very transparent. That's all I can really, so far, that's pretty much what I can tell you, but, you know, a lot of things I haven't been through, a lot of people in their other marriages, so that's the limit of my advice. That's just in the year and a half and over 20 years of, well, almost 20 years of knowing her as a person.
That's good. I'm glad that you...
And leave the toilet seat down. Leave the toilet seat down.
I'm glad that you are with your best friend. So what's next for you? I know that there's something that you can't talk about, but what would you like to achieve?
I have been, speaking of getting your own way, I have been working on this EP project for years. I put out projects. I've been working on the same projects. I wanted to do my life work. It's Eternity, the transition. I already have the album cover. I've had it for years. I'm just working on a good body of work, but I plan to release it this year because I've been working with brand managers and other people in the industry and different labels, and I've been listening to them and building my catalog back up. I don't know if you knew, but last year at about this time, I lost all my music that I've ever created. So I had to start over. And to top that off, I lost a childhood friend within a couple of weeks of that time.
Sorry.
Oh yeah. No, it's all good. But yeah, this time last year was crazy. I almost slipped back into that drinking place, but you know, I was strong enough to pull out of it, get out of my own way, and just start new music. And that's kind of what I've been doing. I have maybe 50 beats now since then. I had thousands at the time, but I'm slowly getting into it because maybe those beats were just practice and I had to look at it that way. But my music's better than ever. If I had to throw away those 1,000 beats to get these 50 now, I would have done it because I've evolved. And you know, when you fall down, you gotta get back up or just quit. I'm definitely not gonna quit. So I've been trying to evolve this Queso series, getting my music out there, working on a single now. We'll have about 5 songs that are potential. So I'm just going back and forth with the label to figure out which one we want to do. And I'm still creating at this time. I'm not rushing. I want to have a good body of work and really, you know, measure 10 times and cut once.
Losing your work is such a big deal. I've had that experience. I had something stolen from me. That's how I lost my work. And I had a cat that also pushed my hard drive off of the counter and helped
me destroy
some things. But actually,
I know somebody who can fix that, though, by the way, because he recovered some of my music that I lost.
Oh, really? How did you lose your music?
Okay. So I've had about 3 drives. One of the drives had my music on. One of the drives was the backup. And for the IT people out there, the startup partition wouldn't work, meaning that when you put the drive in, the computer wouldn't recognize the drive. So the data was there for the startup. It's like having a car with a full tank of gas with no starter engine. You know, so the engine, everything works, but you got to start it up. So that's pretty much what happened. Then the other one crashed, and it all happened at the same time. And I just took it as, you know, God was like, start over. You've gotten to the place you need to be and start and refine yourself. So, but I'm telling you, I was devastated. I cried like a baby for days.
I understand that. I do understand that completely. And I do believe that things lost. Oh, sorry, you're saying something?
No, I'm not saying anything.
Oh, I'm saying I do believe that sometimes when things are lost or destroyed, that it's a new opportunity. And yeah. I'm glad that you were able to embrace it that way. Now, with what you're doing now, how can people find you? I already said lxismusic.com is your website. How else can they?
Yeah, the best way, I think the most efficient way, my handle is lxismusic on every social media account that I have. You can also look up Elijah Alex Harvey, and it has everything on a panel, my Spotify, YouTube, Reverb Nation, Pandora, anything that, you know, anything that you use to listen to music, Tidal. So if you can Google Elijah Alex Harvey, that's one way. Or you can find me at Alexis Music on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, anything.
Okay. Now, recently I saw you post that you found out your music was played at the Emmys.
Oh yeah, that was crazy. So look, I'm with BMI, with one of my companies with BMI. And I rarely check because, you know, with the streaming world this day, you know, I used to sell CDs, so I'm still trying to transition to streaming like I used to. But I'm streaming like everybody else, but CDs is kind of what I used to do. I would say that to say because streams are like 0.001% of a cent per song. So I never really bothered to check. But the other day I was like, hey, let me just check and see what I have. And I saw a couple TV shows that didn't have the names on it. And then I saw the Emmys, and they played one of my songs I released last year, Vibrate Higher. And they gave me a little bit of money for it. And I was like, oh, wow. Now, I wish I could find a clip, but I'll take the money.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's exciting.
Very exciting. And that tells artists, have your stuff ready. ASCAP BMI ready. Because there's a lot of times your songs get played and you may not know it. Get your sound scan ready, all that, because otherwise you're not getting paid.
That's good to know. So you're saying that people should join ASCAP or BMI?
Or CSAC or whatever PRO works for you. You know, there's a lot of them out there now. Back in the day, it used to be BMI, ASCAP. Then CSAC came and other ones. So I just advise everybody to do their research. Just have your name on paper. You know, be able to get people, you know. And another thing, if I can sidetrack, don't put BMI and ASCAP in your bio on your page. It's like saying I have a driver's license. Where are we going? So just get it, and that's how you get your money. When people want to do business with you, and I've done business with a lot of artists that don't have that, and I can't work with them because they can't get paid, and I don't want any kind of weird, you know what I mean? So that's how you bring out the percentages and get your business together. This is a business first.
So in the UK, I think, is it PSAC or something like that in the UK?
PSAC, yeah. Mm-hmm. CSAC.
Yeah, because Choose Love, the song that we have, that I have, I should say, with Tim Ellis, that song is registered in the UK because that's where it was made. But we get...
No, wait. CSAC is in Tennessee.
There's another organization.
Society. It's European, but I think they're in... The headquarters is in Tennessee. It is Tennessee. But it is a European PRO, but I think they're in Tennessee. I could be wrong, but I feel like they're in Tennessee.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it's interesting. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, it's interesting to me how it all works with music and the funding. When we talk about the cents for streaming, it's true. I looked at my account, and I was like, okay, there's money there. That's good, but
yeah,
I would thought there would be more money there. You know,
yeah. Go ahead, fill up the gas tank. You know,
yeah. It's a process. So what would you say to someone? I mean, you just gave good advice about not putting BMI on your bio because that's like having things. What other advice would you give to someone who says, I want to be a musician, and they're going to go ahead, they're willing to put in the work to practice the craft? What would you tell them to do to get started?
Honestly, at this point, I'm kind of jaded with it. So I would have to see them doing it versus them saying it. A lot of people talk. Like, if I see you trying and really wanting to do it versus trying to do a fad or just, you know, that's when I step in. But I will watch you for a while before I can say anything. You know, I would give advice or answer questions if you ask them. But I would just need to see if you're really about it. Because a lot of people just do it for the clout and they don't really love it. And me, you know, learning 5 to 6 instruments and spending the time in it, I'm kind of sensitive about that. You can't just come in here and just, you know, dilly-dally around. So if you're going to do it, do it. If you don't know, figure it out and don't say you're doing it.
Okay.
That's what I think.
Okay. Elijah, what inspires you to be?
To be? What motivates you? So just like to be?
To be who you are, to do what you do.
I don't know. I think I feel like that's my purpose. I feel like that's my assignment on this earth. I love music, but some days I don't feel like doing it. Some days I don't feel like posting up okay. So some days I don't even feel like being on social media. Most days I don't. But I recognize that it could be potentially bigger than me, and I just listen to God, and that inspires me to be. And then, you know, when you put it out there, you know, validation is no longer a goal for me, but just to see some of the responses and how some people are touched, that motivates me to be me. That makes me say, hey, okay, this isn't all for nothing. These hours in the studio, this isn't all for nothing. The views and comments may not match, but you know, if I can touch somebody then and change, you know, the perspective on things, then that's cool. Small steps.
That's cool. Now, one thing I want to ask about Sidetrack. How did you get out of the hole?
The hole of losing my music?
No. Well, no, you said that you decided to create. I'm talking about Sidetrack, the episode of Okay So Today. How did you get
out of the hole? I'm thinking about doing a sequel for that. I have been... I think I have to, yeah. I'm going to have to do a sequel to that next week. That I think you just helped me figure out what I'm going to do next now. So, that might be something. I got an idea. You just inspired me. Okay.
Awesome. Yeah. Glad to hear it. Thank you. You inspire many people, and I wish you tremendous success. Is there anything I haven't asked you that you want to add?
No, you've been a great host. I think you covered everything. More than I expected. I mean, this is awesome. So I think this summer, coronavirus permitting, I'm going to start cooking and showing y'all how to cook on the grill, you know, with the salmon and asparagus and squash and everything. I might have to do that. I might have to do a brand of Shea Harv, but we'll figure it out.
So we're gonna look for. He can cook. I've had his food. He can cook. So look for Alex's cooking, his music, Okeso, and more great things. Alex's.
You gotta pull up for the next meal. Next time I cook, you know, I'm gonna call you. Hope you pull up. Get some salmon.
I will pull up, and I'll bring a bag to take some home. No. I wish you and your family blessings. I thank God that your father is in remission, and
thank you.
Good things. Keep your love.
And I wish you and your family the best too. And I appreciate this podcast. I appreciate talking to you. It's been great to reconnect with you. And you know,
thank you. Be safe. Thanks for all
you do.
Okay.
Blessing. God bless.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Elijah LX Harvey. A young man who delivers with big vision. I hope you enjoyed the episode. We promised to share Okeso from his web series on YouTube. However, with good developments for Elijah, it's now exclusively only available on YouTube. Check out his channel, Elijah LX Harvey. Instead of Okeso, we're going to share a single from Elijah, The Most. Have a listen, and then we'll continue.
Block, 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 block. IG, Facebook, Twitter. I'm taking down all of our pictures. I think I'm gonna need some more liquor. Yeah. Stressed out, like an automatic, I'm triggered. I think I need a woman more realer. And I hope that one day that you figure it out. Yeah, miss me with that, miss me. This week it will be week six that you ain't even hit me with. Side of your mind are you on? Why is it right or it's wrong? I got no part in this song. You say you ride or die. Seems like I'm riding along. I don't do vultures, so carry on. I said I'm on fly with no carry on. Any romance in this dead and gone. If you come up short, we don't get along. You just so happen to get a song. No, I do not wanna get it on. I'd rather break up and not be alone. I'm the best man, you know me alone. You will not be stranding me alone. I'm not your dog, but your leash is on. I'm not the one you can lead along. Set me free, leave me alone. You coming back like you owe me alone. Don't call me back, you can lower your tone. It's just the fact that we grow and move on. Cause you do the most. You do the most. How can you say that you love me? But we only talk with like once a week. Or maybe you're moving with caution. What exactly do you want from me? Other women, they've been giving attention. Now all of a sudden you wanting me. Call you on and now you get all defensive. Swear that you moving mad funny, B. You only wanna chill when it's expensive. I've come to my senses. I should have sensed it. Right from the entrance. My life in an instant. You got me simping. Why am I spending? You independent. And you wonder why I'm distant. And they wonder why I'm distant. You're the most. Block, 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 block. You ain't gotta call me, you ain't gotta text me. Death to the messenger, DM, Snapchat. I'ma need 50 feet back, back. Block, 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 block. Should've known when my folks said they ain't like you. They were right on the vibes, and they be right all the time, that's facts. Block, 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 block. Cause you gotta go, so you gotta roll. Cause you out for gold, and you got no soul. Vibrations is low, so. Block, 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 block. See, either you fold or either you hold. I seen it to know to leave out the dough.
So, what'd you think? I loved it the most. And Elijah offers his best in whatever he does, whether it be his music or his art. Do check out Queso on YouTube. Elijah taught something today, not just giving one's best, but also offering yourself your best. And that's making choices that serve you. Elijah found out that dealing with trauma, dealing with disappointment, dealing with fear, is not always best managed through alcohol, which a lot of people do. And he figured out that what he needed to do was not only offer others his best, but to offer it to himself. Next time on God and Matter, we'll have Manuela Moravihalis. She is an artist, and she is in Cyprus. Until then, thank you for listening to God and Matter, produced by Arlie Speaks Media, LLC. All rights reserved. Our theme music, Running Waters, is by Audionautics, and we are distributed through CastBox and YouTube.com. For more information about God and Matter, visit our website, godandmatter.com. Thank you so much for listening. Please subscribe.